last speaker for the session is David Chai, also from Hebrew University.
Okay, so thanks again for ICO for supporting me for all these years. And I decided to give a talk that kind of summarized some of my activities during this period. A lot of the stuff is Yotamar Hall PhD dissertation. He was a student now in Berkeley. So he did a very good job in going to all universities in Israel. So some of you saw some of the talk, so I apologize for that. But some of stuff are very new.
You can fool all the people some of the time, but you can't.
Okay, so here's the outline. So I will talk about Mittelbox as a network function, and then I'll present briefly, because most people here, or a lot of people here saw it already, the OpenBox framework that we devised in SICOM 16. And then I will describe two case studies with OpenBox. One of them is DPI as a service, which was actually before in Conex 14, and another is very new, it's under submission now, it's fault tolerance as a service. So, and just to mention my colleagues here, so it's a joint work with Anat Brem-Labar, who was the default by Yotam, which I mentioned, Yaron Koral, who was Yuda Fek and Anat student, and now is in AT&T, and Tal Orenstein, who is a master student at UG. Okay, so what are middle boxes or network functions? So they're quite, you know, the same name for both these types. These are functions that are tied within the networks, between the source and destination, you need to process packets. So some examples are a firewall or a security appliances like a network intrusion detection system, or in intrusion prevention systems, and so on. And some are load balancers or NAT or other appliances that are needed for the correct operation of the network. So usually this comes as a monolithic closed boxes that you are going to Juniper or you are going to Checkpoint and you buy this box and you put it somewhere in the network and it receives traffic and they process it and it outputs it and no one really knows what's inside. So it's a monolithic closed black box. This is the traditional middle box. It has high cost. It has limited provisioning and the scalability. For example, you buy this middle box for like 10 gigabytes, and now you need to process 20 gigabytes, so you need to buy another middle box and put it somewhere. If the middle box kind of fail, or it, so you need to physically go somewhere and replace. The trend now, recently, it's going to a network function virtualization, in which you move from this hardware black box to software virtual machines that run the same functionality. So it reduced cost by moving from hardware to software, and it improved provisioning and scalability because you are using virtual machines, and if you want another virtual machine, you can just load another one. And if you are developing a virtual network function, or VNF, and you want to put it in the cloud of the ISP or the network provider, you can just give them a link, and they download it, and it runs. So it gives a lot of flexibility. One more thing about middle boxes is that usually packet that goes from its source to the destination doesn't traverse only one middle box, or one network function, but traverse several network functions. This is called service chaining or policy chaining. So for this chain, for example, so the packet first got to a firewall, and then through the detection system, and then through network antivirus, and then to a traffic shaper. So usually this going to all these passes instead of just the destination is achieved using software-defined networking, which has more flexibility about the routing. It's not just the longest prefix match and go by the destination port. It can look on more header fields and can send stuff from one place to another. And so there is a close relationship between network function virtualization and software-defined networking, especially this traffic steering component of a network of SDN that's responsible of moving packets around the network. So that was all the upside of network function or the advantages of using network function virtualization. But one thing that they lack is management, or very good management or orchestration. So usually these middle boxes or network function come from different vendors. The standardization is very, very in the beginning, so it's not really there. And it's really hard to manage each one of them separately. So when I said, okay, we ran out of bandwidth in one middle box, we want another virtual machine, who actually is doing that? How it's doing that? There is no standard management and no standard control. And OpenBox, and with other suggestion, is one of the frameworks that will enable this management. And what we chose to do is to do a centralized management, which I will show later. Another thing about network function is that we look at them as a monolithic black box, but if you look at sites, they are very, very modular. And most of them are doing the same stuff or similar stuff, sometimes with different configuration. So if we look at these, you know, building blocks, which sometimes called a virtual network function component or VNFCs. So because each VNF vendor or each one that writes its network function doesn't really expose its modular components, no one can really reuse them. And a lot of time the packets that goes through the service chain to the several network functions will go and do the same processing, the same, let's say, blue piece of the puzzle again and again. And one of the things that OpenBox, which I will show now, will do is kind of merge these pieces together in order to speed up the performance. So as I said, it's limited functionalities and limited innovation. Why these, you know, non-modular or not to expose the pieces of the puzzle prevent innovation? Because if you want now to implement the network functions from scratch, you need to write all this stuff together. So you cannot use code of someone else. And a lot of now it's also in the open network automation platform owner advocate for using this modularity in network functions in order to facilitate innovation. So what's OpenBox? So it's a new software-defined framework for network function. When I say it's software-defined, so I'm not talking about, you know, open flow, but about the concept of using a logically centralized control that controls the middle boxes or controls the network function from one logically centralized place that have a network view. We decouple the control plane of each one of these middle boxes from the data plane. So the flows will, after you configure everything here, the flows will go on the data plane or on the data path very quickly. And once in a while, you can change the configuration slowly by this very smart open box controller. What we are going to do is to implement the network function on top of the controller and then to send the code or configure the code in the data plane in order to do this process.
Shalom, Edith.
So the benefit is easier and unified control. It's better performance, scalability, flexible deployment, and inter-tenant isolation, which I'm not going to get into. So if you look at what's the pain point of why we went to this open box controller is because the high cost of middle boxes, the limited provisioning and scalability, and so on about middle boxes. If you look at, you know, what people say about switches, they say exactly the same thing. A switch costs a lot, there is a limited provisioning, limited management, limited functionality, and complex distributed algorithm in order to process the packet. So therefore, OpenBox controller is actually very similar to the framework that devised in order to control the switches, which is software-defined networking. So I don't know if you saw this before, but
we can view OpenBox controller as a software-defined network for middle boxes, like open flow controller is a software defined network for switches and routers on the network.
So just let me go quickly about the framework itself. As I said, it's a, we have a logically centralized controller in the middle. We are implementing a network function on top of this controller. And there is a northbound API that communicates this network function to the controller. The controller itself communicates to open box service instances that run on the servers that are the packet. And this is done through the open box protocol. So packets that go through the data plane just go to the open box service instances, which I will discuss back in the slide, and then go out and continue on towards the destination, towards another service instance if we have a chain. The network functions, we have a language, a network, a northbound API in order that specify how to define network functions, how to define these pieces of the puzzle, and how to make them, to glue them together. Once you define them, the logically centralized controller takes all these network functions and, you know, merge them together in the service chains to for a one big network function that does everything, and then communicate it to the open box protocol. And what the open box protocol does is just configure open box service instances. It has all these blocks available, but it runs only what the open box protocol tells it to run. And if we are going to the details, so this open box service instances is either virtual and or physical, and it provides a lot of these pieces of the puzzle that we already wrote that are very, very common to many network functions. And as I said before, it's controlled by the open box controller. And in our implementation, these pieces of the puzzle are implemented using Qlik, which is a data pass engine for processing packets, switches, or middle boxes. So what's these blocks inside the open source service instances? So there are many of them, queuing blocks, and header modification block, and classification blocks, and transaction blocks, and so on. If you want to add a new block, for example, so the protocol is adaptable, and it can provide the injection of proprietary blocks to the service and instances while the service is still on. So just about the network function API. So with all these blocks, we can define network functions. So this is done on top of the controller. It just defines which blocks each network function comprises and how to connect them. So this, for example, this is a firewall that reads packets, classify it, and then decide either to drop it, to send it on as is, or to alert and send it on. And this is a load balancer that do actually the same. It read packet, it classify it, and then it either output it as is or rewrite the packet in order to do the load balancing. An intrusion prevention system read the packets and then classify it, and then may perform some deep packet inspection in the center of the packet, and then decide to drop to output and to alert. So all these graphs go to the controller, it merges them together, and then it produces the right configuration for the service instance. So it's all these graphs go to the controller, and then it configures the service instances. And this can be done either by graph merging, like taking two network functions together and make them one very, very large graph, or by graph splitting. For example, you have a very large graph in one of the network functions or in the unification of them, and then you want to split it over two service instances that run in different places. This splitting is very important. For example, if you want to use some hardware, special hardware that is available in the network in some of the servers and not all of them. For example, TCAM is used for packet classification or header classification. So what you can do is to split the header classification to the open service instances that has this hardware, and then communicate the result of the classification through a metadata mechanism for example, NSA, Geneve, or Flowtags. It's a standard way to encapsulate packets and send over additional information to the open box service instances that will continue processing the packets. So you can break this chain. So it's not that all the network functions are in one place. You can merge them and break them according to the requirements or according to the bandwidth available in our case. So one of the disadvantages of open box, or the stuff that I get involved with every time that I hear to talk about them, is that network functions doesn't really want to expose their blocks. They want to keep their blocks intact, and they don't want to lose this red piece of the puzzle from this vendor and the blue piece of the puzzle from that vendor and so on. So first, open box work trivially, even if you know it's only one block for network function, because it has other advantages, not just the modularity and the composition and the merging. So this is the first answer. The second answer is that the community itself goes to decomposing VNF. So this is from the VNF cloud readiness requirements for OpenEcomp. OpenEcomp is a general or open network automation platform that is advocated by AT&T and China Mobile. So it's actually OpenEcomp and OpenO together are now ONAP. And if you look at the requirements, so even the first requirement is, or design requirement is, that you should decompose VNFs into granular reusable VNFCs. So this is the second answer for the question, is that maybe you don't expose your VNF, your components now, but maybe you will do it in the future. And the last question, which is the target, is the purpose of this slide, is that sometimes you don't have to expose or to, you know, break down your virtual network function to many, many components, but some components you can go halfway, expose some of your components. For example, of going halfway is your network function has these, you know, pieces of the puzzle. So instead of, you know, having a yellow, a green, blue, and a red, you can have all blue, and one of them is red. So you can outsource to someone else that will do the red piece of the puzzle for you. So what's a good candidate of this outsourcing? Is a component that it's really hard to implement. Because if it's not hard to implement, why you need to outsource it? The second is, this is from the VNF vendor perspective. From the one that implements actually the red piece of the puzzle and give it as a service, it should be very common to many network functions, because otherwise no one will really use this red piece of the puzzle. And the last one is the performance one. If it takes the requirements of the red blocks, red pieces of the puzzle are significantly different than the blue pieces of the puzzle, for example, the scaling requirement, or it takes a lot of time to process stuff in the red puzzle, but very quickly in the blue pieces of the puzzle, so you might want to scale and have two of them or three of them dynamically, it might be beneficial to use this methodology. And if you look at this requirement list from the previous slide, so actually, they actually demand to decompose the function if they have significant different scaling characteristics. Okay.
Can you give an example?
Yes. And this is the example.
So the previous slide is from the VNF vendor's perspective, because it seems like for VNF vendors, this might actually be the reason not to outsource something. Right? Because it's
this hard for some. Okay, so how to implement? It depends, you know. So
I have secret sauce, and I don't want to outsource it.
Or you want to use off-the-shelf how to implement components because your IP is in somewhere else, you know, DPIs, which is it's very common. So you don't want to develop now 2 months of or 2 years of development in order to do this decoupling experiment. You just want to use it as a service. So this is the VNF provider perspective. This is the one that actually implements the piece of the puzzle. This is the second, because we want to comment. And the third is all of them together. And
one of them is the one that uses the VNF because it wants to, you know, to do different things, different components of using the VNF.
So so deep packet inspection is one of these candidates. So DPI, if it's deep packet inspection, it's so the meaning of this piece of the file is you are giving a packet and you want to classify it according to the payload of the packet, rather only this metadata or the header. So a lot of classification is done by the header, for example, routing. But if you are in security appliances or you are doing layer 7 load balancing, layer 7 something, you already need to go inside and look. There are many flavors of deep packet inspection. Very common in security appliances is look at the payload of the packet and start to match it against a set of strings or set of regular expressions and to see if this regular expression, for example, virus signatures, are inside these packets. So why DPI is a good candidate? So in a lot of this network function virtualization, because DPI goes into the packet and just not just go to the header, the DPI is the bottleneck. So if in security appliances, if you look at how much time, how much processing time is spent on DPI, it's about between 30 to 80%. So a lot of it makes sense to have, you know, if we are scarcing resources, to have two parallel DPIs together, or three or four, in order to cope with the with this bottleneck. The other slide here, which I'm not going to this list, is that it's hard to implement and it has many flavors, and therefore it's and you know everyone that knows me knows that I did a lot of research about DPI, but I'm not the only one. So there are hundreds of academic papers in, you know, DPI about scalability, about different type of traffic, about different type of patterns, about security of the DPI, and so on and so forth. And the last requirement is that it's very common. And if you look at the VNFs that actually use DPI, so there are a lot of them. So actually, a lot of them are related to security, for example, layer 7 firewalls or intrusion detection system or leakage prevention system that looks in at the incoming or at the outgoing traffic from the network. But they are not the only one. Layer 7 load balancer, for example, that goes to the headers of the HTTP or the headers of the application and by that decide how to load balance. Traffic shaping, a lot of time depends on the application layer itself and therefore we need to go into this DPI. So how much time do I have? 5 minutes. So I have only 5 minutes, so I will go very quickly. So our proposal here in this context, or what it boils down when you look at a open box with this one piece of the puzzle, is to provide DPI as a service. So you have this red piece of the puzzle in each one of these middle boxes over the chain. You can have a separate middle box that do only DPI as a service for all the others. And the way we are going to achieve it is very similar to this graph splitting that I showed in the open box slide before. So what we are going to do is actually have a DPI service instance that do this DPI service, and then it communicates the results of the DPI to the rest of the middle box or virtual NF or the open box service instances that goes down the line. So the amount of meta, so how to do the, how to communicate the metadata, I told you already, it's do with NSH, Geneve, or flow tags. The amount of metadata is, so we have these patterns of how to do it, but if you look at the amount of metadata, so most of the time, if you look at security applications, this DPI goes over the packet and found nothing. So it's like 95% of the time, it has a 0-byte metadata, so it doesn't really cost us anything to do the DPI somewhere else. In the other 5%, if you look at the amount of data that it communicates, it's less than 200 bytes. So the metadata, so
In extreme cases, there is a lot of metadata communicate, but that means that something wrong say happened, and maybe you're taking a picture. So, something wrong happened, and maybe we need to do something else. So the last case study that I'm not going to go to now because we ran out of time is our actually recent work is about fault tolerance. So the shift from middle boxes that are hardware and monolithic and very and tested in very specific conditions in very specific environments to virtual machines, to virtual network functions that run on virtual machines on servers that I don't know which one of them. And with vendors that I don't know how to handle, and sometimes the testing is not as much as in hardware. In hardware, cause a lot of problems, a lot of failures, and there is a lot of therefore it requires a fault tolerance to be considered. It's challenging because network functions are not just, you know, taking packets, looking at them, and then output them without state. They are even, you know, the most common one, like a network address translation, has state inside. So if something fails, you need to retrieve the state to continue from that state in order not to lose the context of what it did before. It's not only states, it's sometimes even non-determinism, because the network function usually are, if they are implemented in software, they are multi-threaded. So if you think about NAT, packets arrive, and even the orders in which they arrive, or in which the threading goes, determine which results they get, which will be their source address. So we need to take into account this, you know, non-determinism in order when we are going to deal with, you know, failed components. And the other thing is that, you know, there are a lot of literature, and you know, I actually waited for it because she did did a lot of stuff about fault tolerance before. A lot of stuff is applicable to our setting, but a lot of stuff is not because there is very, very low latency and the requirements are very, very strict, so you cannot really do a lot of sophisticated stuff in this environment. So actually, I think that I will stop here. Oh, I have 2 minutes. So the state of the art currently is something that looks, you know, stuff that was done in the 80s and the 90s. It's called rollback recovery. It's a C compiler by this, you know, group in Berkeley and Intel that they are doing for each network function separately. It actually logs, it saves them. It logs all the actions, all the state changes that is done. And then in the end of the execution, it outputs them. And so you have this persistent storage in which you have the packet, and then you have all the processing, the order of processing and the changes in the state. And then after everything is logged, you can output the packet to the next next hop in the chain. Once in a while, in order, so you save all the packets, and once in a while you take a snapshot of the system, and then you can, you know, throw away all the packets that you stored, and then continue from the snapshot. If something fails, you actually replay all the packets that you have stored. So you are going to the last snapshot, you're replaying all the packets that you saved in the input logger, you apply all this, what they call determinants or paths that change the state exactly the same way, and then in the end you can output them. So if you look at the delay that it's caused, so you have this, you know, very fixed delay with, you know, all these snapshots that goes all the way. So because I ran out of time, I just explained without slides what we did. So we took another approach just to get this over with all these snapshots. So we have a very constant fault tolerance that they're actually doing. We have a master and a slave, and the slave is actually following the master in a very particular way in order to cope with this non-determinism and these and shared state and reduce the cost of SNAPs. So that's one benefit, and the other benefit is that we are not going to treat each network function separately, but we are going to treat the entire service chains together, and we can, you know, save the packet only once in the beginning of the chain and release it in the end.
When you have open box, right? Then you have like a centralized service that configures the network graph, comes up with a solution, and you just deploy it all at once to the whole network.
No, we have this input of where you know there is service, open box service instances,
yes.
And where the traffic, the specific traffic will go to the policy chain, which network segment it traverses, and so we deploy all the stuff that we need.
But what I mean, you do it simultaneously in all the points where you need to. You assume that you can do it atomically in the entire network.
We didn't, you know, go through all these details, but there are a lot of, you know, work about SDN, about, you know, gradual deployment, and I think that it applies here as well. So we didn't, you know, think about the exactly this in the gradual deployment.
Okay, let's take other questions offline.
Thank you.